करना चाहते हैं वो खत्म होने के बाद ही आप यहाँ से निकले अगले सेशन के लिए. सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल फॉर्मल इंट्रोडक्शन, अ वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल द लिटरेचर फिक्शन एंड नॉन फिक्शन फैंस. आई लिपि गोयल अलॉन्ग विथ मिताली वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर द सेशन I also welcome all the storytellers, story writers, journalists, bloggers, social media enthusiastic students and freelancers present over here. Well, in case I have missed out on any literary creator, I welcome that special guest once again over here. I would now like to invite the moderator for the session over here. But before I invite, a small brief about couple of lines about her. Well, it is said that education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change the world. We have a torchbearer over here of progressive education who has more than 2 decades of experience in teaching. She has received the Rashtriya Gaurav Award, the Glory of India Gold Award, and the Best Citizen of India Award. She conducts a lot of workshops for parents. She's also the founder of Mahatma Gandhi International School, an educator, a columnist, an educational script writer, and a master trainer. Okay, that's quite a list now. Let's welcome Anju Musafir on stage with a huge round of applause for the next session. I think taliya thodi kam hai inki qualification ke hisab se. Lovely. Thank you so much. And Mitali will invite our next guest. Over to you.
Further, I would like to invite Anita Karwal, who is the IAS Principal Secretary GAD and Director General of Sardar Patel Institute of Public Administration. Along with her, we have her talented daughter Janvi Karwal, who is a talented filmmaker, producer, as well as a cinematographer. She has worked for more than 40 films and also has made the trailer of the next book that is called Everest, The Same Path and Different Peaks. Please put your hands together for both of them. Without taking further time, I would request Anju ma'am to take the session forward, and I hope you enjoy.
Okay, good afternoon everyone, and welcome to this session. The book that we're going to talk about today, it is this beautiful large coffee table book, and it's called Everest, Same Path, Different Peak. But before we embark on this journey, we're going to actually start by watching a short book trailer which Janvi, this young girl here, has made. So may I first request you to play this? Aap play kar sakte hain? So invite the audience to watch the book trailer.
Raso hamaste konte prabhasmi shashi su Pranava sarve vedeshu shaktah ke purusham drushu. Siddhyoha Samo Bhutva samatvam yog uchate.
Thank you. So the first question I'm going to ask Janvi is that I'm not familiar really with this genre of book trailers. It seems to be happening a bit in the West, but in India we haven't really seen that many books released with a book trailer as a film. So Janvi not only made this film, but she actually shot it herself by going to the mountains there and actually went to the base camp. So I'd like her to talk a little bit about it. Well, at least she went to the mountains.
Hi. Actually, that's exactly right. It's not very prevalent as a thing in India. People haven't really started making book trailers yet. But in the West, it's picked up a lot. And I actually saw a book trailer of an Indian writer. And then, in fact, she was my mother's aunt. That's how I was like, oh, wow, there's book trailers now. Because, I mean, there's trailers for everything else. There's advertisements, so why not for books? I went to Gulmarg. And the snow was just starting to melt. So it looks a little bit like it's starting to become spring, but we made it work and we shot the trailer.
Okay, so what I did miss out, what I mixed up was that actually Janvi has done mountain climbing as well, and she's done it at the Nehru Foundation, Nehru Institute of Mountaineering. She, at the age of 17, she's been one of the youngest people who's allowed to go to do the mountaineering course. And as a result of that that course, and being a filmmaker, she was able to actually recreate some of the shots, which obviously she wasn't there during the trip made by Mr. Atul Karwal. So that is how she was able to combine the two knowledge.
We got some mountaineering equipment, and we got some people to dress up like they would be on Everest. And then I made them run up and down the slopes a few times, so they were tired and panting. And then I made them, then we shot the six shots.
I can tell you she's a pretty tough taskmaster, because she's been a student of mine, and 5:30 shooting in the morning, because we have a filmmaking course, would mean that she would round up everybody at 5 o'clock and be at the shoot. So here is a young woman of this country doing some amazing work. And I think as an audience for all of us, to think about this new emerging genre of book trailers is very exciting. So I think it was interesting to see that little clip. Janvi, what are the difficulties you might have faced while making it?
I think the first problem, and I still struggle with it, is to kind of capture the essence of a book in a film, because they're completely different mediums of information, and especially with a coffee table book where there's no real storyline, but there's verses from the Gita and then there are these photographs. So how do you combine the two? That was a problem initially. And the other was, of course, getting to the location, and I didn't want it to just be photographs. I wanted to be able to hear the person panting and to get a sense of what it takes to climb Everest.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Janvi. All right, so let's move on to the book now. This book is called Everest, Same Path, Different Peak. And very interestingly, this is a book about Atul Karwal's journey to Mount Everest, but it is interspersed with verses from Bhagavad Gita, which have been adapted by Anita Karwal to the photographs. Now, Atul Karwal himself, who is an IPS officer, as you all know from Gujarat cadre, himself actually climbed the peak. He himself shot the pictures. So that is, there's several questions. First of all, you're climbing a peak in very, very difficult conditions. How in the wide world do you have the cameras along with you and you're actually clicking pictures? You're running low on oxygen, you're packs, these kilos of baggage and everything. So let's start from the beginning. They've already written a book called Think Everest. So Anita, why the second book, first of all? Why did you write a book called Everest Again and Same Path, Different Peak?
Okay, so we wrote the first book called Think Everest in 2010. And it was a highly descriptive book about the climb, and we sort of tried to put in an element of thrill into the book. Mm-hmm. But if any of you have seen the book, it has black and white photographs, some of them, and a few colored photographs interspersed here and there. And I have this Facebook page, and I mean, I'm interacting a lot on my email with my readers. And I used to get a lot of demand that, you either start blogging or you sort of put the photographs, we want to actually experience and see what's going on. So if you'll see on the screen right now, you will see pages from the book. So we decided that once Atul had finished this Everest, and when we launched the book, the first book, His Holiness the Dalai Lama in fact told us at that time that the higher you climb, the further you see. And that is something which actually triggered off a different kind of inspiration within both of us. And we both felt that actually climbing Mount Everest was something like a spiritual experience for him, adventure for him, a huge spiritual experience for me, an inspiration for my daughter because she became a mountaineer after that. So it had sort of changed our lives so much that we decided that we need to add the spirituality angle to the whole climb. So that is how we came out with this.
So, audience, I think what's really interesting is
in this book
that becomes a metaphor. Everybody has a mountain to climb. What that mountain is, only you will know. But how the process of climbing it, the process of overcoming those obstacles, whether it's a real mountain like Everest or it's an internal peak that you have to overcome, that journey is a spiritual journey. So, in the book that Anita and Atul have written, the climbing process that Atul Karwal did was actually physical, but at the same time it was intensely spiritual, and hence the choice of, I think, the Bhagavad Gita. Now what I'd like to ask Anita is, how difficult was it to take verses from Bhagavad Gita and adapt it to the images that you had? Because Bhagavad Gita is not all the time talking about a mountain. You had to put in words related to the mountain and the whole process of climbing. So how did you do that?
Okay, so now this is a very difficult process. Sanskrit I had learnt in school, and you know, we used to really shun the subject. So, and once I left school, I sort of got out of touch with Sanskrit. After this experience in 2010 and our interaction with His Holiness, it was the first time I picked up a Bhagavad Gita to read. I had not read it before. And believe me, the experience that I had was as if I'm reading a thriller, because it builds up a momentum, you know, the 18 chapters, the 700 verses. So I obviously started reading in English. Then one after the other, I started reading several interpretations. It took me 4 years to even begin to understand. I cannot even say that I understand even 10% of the Bhagavad Gita today. I have only begun to understand it. After 4 years of reading more than 8 or 10 interpretations, trying to understand a bit of Sanskrit, then I started work on this book, and it took me 2 years just to translate 101 verses out of those 700 verses.
So just to give you a little glimpse of this sonority of it, the chapter in the beginning is called, "In the beginning there is doubt." And this is what Anita has translated and adapted the verse as. Are you wondering if you wish to climb or you don't? Are the pain and the risk really worth the ascent? Will the mountain soul bless you? Or she won't. Will you conquer her or be conquered in the end? So you see how the spiritual dimension, the verses are there in Sanskrit. The transliteration is there in English. So this book is very much for an international audience as well.
That's what intersperse here.
Yeah.
So this is the first, the portion where Arjuna has the doubt.
Mm-hmm.
Now he's in the battle of Mahabharata. Krishna is there on the chariot, and Arjuna sees on the other side that his brothers, the Kauravas, his family members, his teacher, Dronacharya, everybody is there right in front of him, and with his army he is about to attack them. And that is a time when doubts creep into his mind, you know, whether he should actually go ahead with this. And then he starts questioning Lord Krishna that, you know, what am I doing? Why am I here?
Mm.
This is exactly what happened when Atul climbed the mountain. So he had been having this thing for so many years that he wanted to climb the Mount Everest, and he had no mountaineering experience at all. He had not even done the basic mountaineering course in his life. One fine day he gets a call from Government of India in Delhi that a police expedition is going and only jawans of the police are going. No police officer is ready to go. So police officer means an IPS, Indian Police Service officer. Are you prepared to go? So he said, I have to ask my home department, which means me. And I was sitting right there. So I said, home department is approved. You go. Because all these years that I have been married to him, he used to dream of Everest. You know, when he bought his iPod, he named it Everest. Even his pen drives used to be called Everest. Everything was called Everest. So I knew what he really wanted. So we said, okay, you should go. That is when he started doing his first mountaineering course. When he went to the mountaineering course, the doubts began. Because in that mountaineering course, out of 150 people, 40 had to be chosen to climb. He wasn't sure whether he'll make it. And he was up against jawans. They were 20 to 25 years old. They were from mountaineering districts and states like Himachal Pradesh, Kashmir. He's a Punjabi and let us say bred in Gujarat, you know, for so many years. And you know, you sort of come into a life routine and which is very different from those guys. So the first doubt came then. After that he was selected. Then in the second round again they had to select only 15. He was selected. When he went to the Everest base camp, his own teammates betted against him that this is one guy who will not make it to the peak. This was the way it was. And you can imagine the kind of doubts that there were. So this Gita, you know, it expresses it so beautifully. The first part, you know, when you're addressing your faith, your everything to the universe and saying, am I going to be able to do it? So that's how I have begun this book.
So, you know, it seems to be that the universe always conspires to make things happen once you open up your intent and your will. And what's interesting is we all know Anita as a columnist as well. She's been writing earlier for Ahmedabad Mirror and now for DNA. And her sense of humor is absolutely incredible. She makes us laugh, you know, putting in quantum physics and the Indian bureaucracy, which is pretty difficult for an IAS officer to make fun of the IAS officers. And that's pretty remarkable that she can get away with it. But I'd like to tell you just a little, read out to you a little part from the book where she says that, you know, she talks about Atul's sense of humor. And it's remarkable that you can have something so serious as a, you know, topic like, you know, using Bhagavad Gita and the verses and the spiritual climbing. You can have so much of humor in it. So I'm just reading out to you. Anita asks to Atul, where are you going? Atul, there. Anita says, when will you reach? Atul, then. So Anita says, why are you going? And Atul says, because. So Atul says, who are you? Atul says, that. Then Anita says, who am I? And Atul says, that. So these are the conversations they used to have when Atul would want to pull her leg. So you can see, actually, even in that sense of pulling her leg, I found that, wow, there is really a great spiritual streak, because even that very laconic sense of humor, there was an underlying grit and determination, a much deeper sense of the mystery of life. So let's go to another question.
So I would like to explain this. So the Gita is based on three words. I'm sure there are people who are much more educated than me about the Gita, the Bhagavad Gita, here in the audience. But this is my understanding. So tat tvam asi, thou art that. Meaning that the Supreme Consciousness and you are the same. Thou art that. You are the same as that person, as the Brahman, as the Supreme Consciousness. So when Atul used to pull my leg like this, I used to say, who are you? He'll say, that. Who am I? That. At the end of the day, when I started doing this Gita translation, I realized that, you know, the universe was conspiring, you know, to put us on this journey. It was showing us the way in many different ways, through comedy, through humor, through spirituality, through adventure.
So Anita, this brings to another question that, you know, you are a very busy officer. And you have very, very long working hours. And at the same time, you've been able to write several books. And this one, of course, again, being a very different and a very researched book. How did you find the time to juggle between, you know, office work and long hours and book writing?
I think my children grew up. So both my children went off to college. And while they were around, I used to be just a columnist with Mirror. And I have this thing inside me, you know, in the middle of the night, I get up and I write. So it just comes in my head and I start writing. And while the children were around, I was busy and I liked to be busy with them. I really enjoyed it while it lasted. But when they left, there was this gap in my life. And as some of you might know, and the previous discussion was taking place and I was feeling this surge inside me. My husband is posted in Kashmir. That is why he's not here. He's, for the past 2 years, he's posted there and he's fighting the forces, whatever you may call them. So, I mean, I was sort of finding that gap. And I thought, instead of sort of, you know, mulling over it, best is to get back into what my hobby is. And that's how I started doing this, finished this book, and we launched this in April. And now I'm coming out with my third book, so which would be a humorous travelogue on Kailash Mansarovar Yatra. So you will find Kailash Mansarovar Yatra written in many ways, you know, very spiritual and this. But what you will find here is a humorous travelogue on Kailash Mansarovar Yatra. Wow, that is really amazing. You know, we're looking at a great, very prolific kind of work coming from you, Anita. What are the kind of difficulties and challenges you faced in this journey of compiling this book? Anju, the main challenge was Sanskrit, let me be very frank, and bless these apps. I have downloaded these Sanskrit apps, and even today I'm learning from them, you know, the Vyakaran and the everything and the grammar. I'm trying to pick up the language. That is why I'm saying that my knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita is not 100%, because I have learned it through English interpretations. The direct interpretation I'm able to do to some extent now, but not to a great extent. So this was my biggest challenge. Second challenge, as you rightly mentioned, my time being a bureaucrat. I work 6 days a week at my will, and 7 days a week at somebody else's will. So I hardly have any time. And but whatever little time I get, believe me, I indulge myself in reading. Recently, my daughter on my birthday last month presented me 8 volumes of books on Buddha, 1 to 8. And she was surprised after she met me after 15 days, I had finished 7 volumes, and she said, "What are you doing?" Because I just can't imagine a life without reading. I think it's the biggest gift to mankind. You know,
it is. Yeah. Well, that's a story behind the book and a very remarkable couple. An IPS officer who's right now fighting terrorist forces in Kashmir. Somebody who with his own grit and determination, you know, climbed the biggest peak which is there in this world. And I think this is really a remarkable couple. This is a remarkable book. It is an intensely visual spectacle. I'm sure you've seen some of the slides there. But I think more than anything, listening to her, I think is the inspiration that we can all draw, you know, from her own journey, the struggle to put this book together, and all that lesson that comes with it. And I think, you know, when we hear about this, that the faith can move mountains, you know, there's something deeply inspiring about mountains. So I would really encourage you to explore this book.
Really sorry.
Okay, the mic.
It's a very motivational session right now, and I'm so sorry to interrupt. Just 2 minutes, there's an announcement which needs attention. The session of Vinod's View in the Diamond Mine at 5:30 has been shifted to 4:30. It has already started, and that's why anybody who's been interested to see that session or be a part of that session, it started. And the session which was at 4:30, the pull of Pulakit, that has been moved to 5:30. So there has just been a swap. So anyone who's interested, please be there. Thank you so much. I'm really sorry again.
I would just like to read just 2 or 3 verses, my adaptation of the Bhagavad Gita, and just in case it interests you. And I'll just give you a background. So when Lord Krishna is telling Arjuna that everything is me, and I'm telling you that you go ahead, because sab kuch upar se likh ke aaya hai. So how does he tell it to him? He says, in the earth after rains, the scent is me. In the fire that you light, the foment is me. In the climb you undertake, the intent is me. In the life you shall live, the extent is me. So he is actually telling ki kuch bhi tumhara nahi hai. Everything is actually, there is a higher grandeur, and there is something which is, you know, pulling your strings. So that is one verse which I really love in the Gita. There is another verse which I would just like to, this is something which we are, you know, undergoing every day, and there's a lot of problem of inner conflict. There is a theory that Mahabharata is actually not a real story. It is actually a metaphor for the inner Mahabharata which goes on inside us. Hum sabke andar ek, there is a Mahabharata going on inside us. And there is a Krishna who's trying to pull us out of the Mahabharata. And we, the Arjunas, are trying to make something out of it.
And those five horses, you know, they are our senses. Pleasure, pain, desire, greed, all these senses, these are the horses which are pulling us in different directions. So there is this theory, and I firmly believe that this Mahabharata was written for this purpose. And the Gita is actually a part of that metaphor for explaining to the civilization to, you know, sort of get over conflict and greed and corruption. So this is one such verse, which is actually in Adhyaya 5, and it is verse 23. Emotions of anger, ambition and passion are like weeds in the mind, rooted and thronged. Control them and climb in a soulful fashion, like a yogi in a state of meditation prolonged. Then, O climber, know that we are one, since gods conspired and consciousness begun. Hence, to climb and scale these glorious peaks, first rejoice in oneness, then further seek. So, the Mahabharata, the Bhagavad Gita is actually, it is so clearly telling us that the outside conflict is what reflects inside, and the inside conflict is what will show outside. If there is oneness in the outside and the inside, then it is very easy to be able to handle what is coming at you, what is being thrown at you. So when Atul was climbing, let me tell you two or three things that happened with him. One, he was 44 years old. He was the oldest person there. Two, he had never done a mountain before, except that tiny mountain on which he had learned mountaineering. He had never done. This was his first mountain. Now when he goes to climb, and they start the peak bid, the summit bid it is called, I think somewhere around 24,000 feet, they wear something called crampons in their feet, you know, on their boots, and it gives a purchase on the snow. One of his crampons came off, and when it comes off, he fell. And you can fall straight into a crevasse which is 500 meters below. And nobody will know what happened to you, and your body cannot be retrieved after that. He fell almost 200 meters, but somehow something broke his fall. And when you have fallen and you don't have a crampon, you cannot go on. Neither you can go up nor you can go down. Suddenly, and there was nobody with him at that time, suddenly his Sherpa just happened to walk by and realized he doesn't have a crampon. And he saw the crampon hanging somewhere else. He picked it up and he puts it on, and then he climbed. Then when they reach camp 4, which is called the death zone, 26,000 feet, beyond that no living being can survive. That is called death zone, and the Everest peak is at 28,800 feet. So they were already in the death zone, and his oxygen got over. Now when the oxygen gets over, because you have to be on oxygen all the time, there is nobody who shares oxygen with you, because everybody is carrying their oxygen on the back, and it's really very, very heavy. But it so happens at that time when he's panting and he doesn't know whether to go up or to come down, one fellow comes along saying, oh, I have two bottles, I have two, you know, oxygen, and he gives it to him. The third incident, in the night they are climbing for the summit bid, and he gets diarrhea. Now when you get diarrhea, you lose salts, you cannot climb. And you cannot imagine how difficult it is to climb. We do a lot of trekking as a family, and hum log, matlab, I did Kailash Mansarovar, it was so difficult, I felt I was going to die. It's really tough. So there he was with 30% oxygen in the atmosphere, having diarrhea, and he didn't know what to do. Of course, he sat down right there, wherever he was in the route. But after that one episode, nothing happened, and he managed, and he reached the peak. So it is some faith, some spirituality, something which was deep within, you know, which pushed him and took him there. And believe me, for 3 months when he was away, he was not in touch with us. There was no way he could get in touch with us, only satellite phones, and that too once in 20 days, the base camp people would call us and say, he's fine. The day he was going on top of the peak, he was doing the summit bid, we were told he's doing the summit bid. And I had studied everything about Everest. There was a Harvard case study about what happened to 12 people who died. I studied everything, ki usme kya gadbad ho sakti hai. So when he was climbing, we guys didn't sleep, three of us, me and my two daughters, the whole night we didn't sleep. In the morning at 8:30,
I get a call from the base camp, your husband has conquered the Everest, which Atul hates to use the word conquer. You cannot conquer that mountain. That mountain has lived as long as the earth. We are just here and gone in a flash. So anyway, he had scaled, but we were not happy, because from the peak to the camp too, you can slip and lose your life, because that's the time when the sun comes out and the snow starts melting. So what I'm trying to tell you is that having gone through all these experiences, you just become spiritual. You have this ultimate faith in that guy there, that supreme consciousness, and you know that this guy is taking care of you. That's what the book is about. Thank you, Anita. I think this is really the kind of book in the evenings you can sit quietly, just pick it up, open any page, and you have the most remarkable images and the most remarkable wisdom coming from a book like Bhagavad Gita. Now I think we can throw open the session to the audience. I can see that there are already eager participants there. So yes, let's take the questions.
I have undergone such a spiritual journey myself, and so I would like to ask you the difference, the slight line of difference, I don't know whether you have figured it out or not, between fear and nervousness.
Actually, as Atul believes and we all believe, that fear is the propelling factor for courage. If you don't have fear, that courage will not come. In fact, Atul has been talking about this to youngsters, that it was his fear of skydiving which made him skydive. It was his fear of mountaineering which made him push his limits, find out if he has the resources, the limitations. So I think they're very interrelated. Even my daughter believes that it is fear of various things. You know, she skydived in 2010, and you sort of go in a plane and wear a parachute and you jump from the plane, and the first skydive she crash landed and broke a lot of bones. But she got over the fear, now she's ready to do it again, you know. So it is that fear which is a very, very, very important factor in our lives. If it is not there, I think courage will also not be there.
Anybody else? Yes. नमस्ते मैम, आपको फैमिली और ये वर्क प्लेस दोनों को मैनेज करने में कभी मुश्किल हुई? पर्सनल क्वेश्चन है, प्लीज. थैंक यू.
बहुत मुश्किल. मुझे तो सरकार मुझे शो कॉज नोटिस दे देगी अगर मैं सच बता दूँ तो. मुश्किल होती है, बहुत मुश्किल होती है. हम लोग की छोटे छोटे बच्चे को लेकर के हम लोग की अलग अलग ट्रांसफ़र हो जाती है, वो कहीं और होते हैं, मैं कहीं और. कभी कभी हम लोग बच्चे डिवाइड कर लेते थे, कभी एक के पास रखते थे, कभी डिपेंडिंग ऑन किसकी पोस्टिंग में ज़्यादा यू नो प्रॉब्लम है, मतलब इन द सेंस ज़्यादा प्रेशर है. तो हम लोग को काफ़ी मुश्किल हुई है. आज भी आप देख रहे हो हम लोग चार दिशाओं में रहते हैं. हम लोग अतुल श्रीनगर में रहते हैं, मैं यहाँ रहती हूँ, एक बेटी अमेरिका में पढ़ाई कर रही है, ये बेटी बैंगलोर में काम करती है. This is we've got used to it, but this is not the best way to live. No, but believe me, spirituality helps. So since I read a lot and I'm a little bit into meditation and all, so mujhe it helps.
How many times have you consulted your husband when you have written both the books, Think Everest and this one? Because he has been the one who climbed it, you have been the one who wrote it. So how many times did you turn to him?
This is a very interesting question. So the first book, when I wrote it, that time I was on medical leave for some reason, and Think Everest, for 3 months I had to go on medical leave, and I thought, since there's nothing better to do, let me write a book. So he would come back in the evening and we would fight over every word written. And then after that, come to some, you know, conclusion. So I would interview him in the morning before he would go, ki aaj main ye chapter likh rahi hu. take down notes. In the evening, I would write it, and then we would fight over it, and then finalize it. The second book is entirely written by me, but he did help in editing here and there. And you are my editor, Anurita. So you are the main person who helped me edit it.
Hello, ma'am. What was your first reaction here when you hear Atul sir's voice over phone after climbing the Everest, or you met him?
Actually, when he was at the peak, he could not call because there was no satellite phone. Nahi tha. But some other country had a satellite phone. I think the Thai people had. So through that, they conveyed to the base camp that he has climbed, and I got a message. Then he came down to camp 4, still in death zone. And then there they had a phone, sat phone. So from there, when he called me, he could not speak. Because you know what happens is at that height, it's very dry. There's no oxygen. And you've been breathing through your mouth with a lot of force. So he could not speak much. All he said was, I'm fine. Can you tell my mother and my sister and the children, I'm fine. That's all he could say. And all I could tell him was, now you're going down, you're climbing down, be very, very careful. And first thing you have to do is when you reach base camp, give me a call. So it was like, what shall I say? I was disturbed. When he reached the base camp, that's the time we were relieved. Until then, I was very disturbed.
Are we likely to see a role reversal in some time in the future where you will be doing some climbing or journey and he will write a book or...
Yeah, in my next birth.
मैडम आप ऐसे कोई लिविंग स्पिरिचुअल पर्सन से मिली है क्योंकि मैंने एक कोट यहाँ पे श्रीम का देखा था तो नहीं नहीं आपकी बुक में यस ऐसे कोई आपको ऐसा कोई एक्सपीरियंस हुआ हो स्पिरिचुअल तो पर्सन से मिलके या फिर रीडिंग से
हुआ है और मैं थोड़ा हेजिटेंट हूँ उसके बारे में बात करने के बारे में क्योंकि वो काफ़ी पर्सनल एक्सपीरियंस है और मेरे ख्याल से जो लोग समझते हैं शायद मैं उनके साथ शेयर कर सकूं अदरवाइज आई विल फाइंड इट डिफिकल्ट
मैम आई हैव हर्ड समवेयर दैट इफ आई एम नॉट रॉन्ग अतुल सर हैज लॉस्ट समवेयर अराउंड 32 केजीज ऑफ वेट आफ्टर द क्लाइंबिंग
नो ही लॉस्ट 12 केजीज ही वाज टोल्ड टू बीफ अप यू नो व्हेन ही वेंट बिकॉज दे हैड टोल्ड हिम दैट ही विल लूज वेट So he's not a very large eater. He eats very small amounts. तो वो प्लेट पर हम लोग भरते जाते थे कि खाओ 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 He was not able to put on much weight. So when he left, he was barely, I think, 73 kgs and he lost 12 kgs. And what happened was when he came back from the base camp to Kathmandu, and I could take it no more, you know, I was so anxious that I decided to fly to Kathmandu to see him. Because he was going to be there for 5 days. So I went to Kathmandu and he came to the airport to receive me. And he told me he'll be there. And I went out to look for him and I didn't recognize him. He had become so thin. He was standing there and I went past and I kept looking and I didn't recognize him.
You just mentioned your kids. Kind of in a split way in which you know they were kind of grown up because of your schedule. Was there any influence from any one of you in a more way than someone else?
On the children?
Yes, because the way they were grown up because of your schedule.
I think my kids take a lot of inspiration from their father. He is a person who brings laughter in our lives and adventure in our lives. And I am not from Gujarat, as you may be aware. I am from a state called Bihar, and some of you may know that place. And he is from Punjab. Now, Biharis are, you know, mild, soft people. Punjabis are aggressive, adventurous people. And my children, I think they have taken more from their father than from me. They are more Panjus than Biharis.
Hello, ma'am. Here.
Actually, 2 years back, I heard your interview on some radio channel where you said that your daughter also wants to go with Atul sir. So we know from the your ex interviews that you were like scared when Atul sir went there. So when like if this is happening again and both of your quite nearest people are going, so I mean the scaredness does like how do you take it?
Okay, so on the Everest, one out of every 10 persons who goes doesn't come back. And sometimes it becomes more than that, depending on the weather. And the weather can never be predicted. So yes, this daughter who is sitting here, she is as wild as my husband. And so these two keep planning. After her accident from the skydiving, it took her some time to recover. But now that she's okay, they do talk about it. In fact, last year, when the Nepal earthquake happened, that year, if you recall, 5 IAS and IPS officers had gone to climb the Everest, which included one IPS officer from Gujarat. Atul was going to lead that delegation. But something, my intuition said that he should not go, because he was approached at the last minute and I said, you have not practiced, you have done no mountaineering, you need 1 year and you've been given 1 month, so I will not let you go. So I put my foot down and these people left and the earthquake happened and they never could, you know, beyond base camp they could not go, they had to come back. In fact, one of them was seriously injured also. But yes, you never know when they'll spring a surprise on me, but as long as they are prepared, it's all right. You know, the universe, usko jo karna hai wo to karega hi. If I have to die today, yehi mere sir pe gir jayega, I will die. So I don't think I need to worry about that, about death and injury. And that's what Gita teaches you. Don't worry about it. It will come in its time, you know. It's a question of what you really want to do in life and does it connect you to the energies of the universe? If yes, just go ahead and do it.
Okay, I think I'm going to ask one question to Anita, which I was very curious about. And that is about the cameras. You know, I mean, Atul has clicked these wonderful pictures. They're really beautiful, very serene, very inspiring. So I asked Anita, and I want to know from her, how did he carry these cameras? I mean, you're just so busy. Like I said, it's so difficult just to even breathe.
Okay, so Atul will, if he has to carry just 2 things, you know, to a place where he's going to be marooned for the rest of his life, he will carry camera and food. He's like that. So he carries his camera everywhere. But you know, the problem in Everest is that the temperature is in minus 30, minus 50. So camera batteries freeze. So beyond a point, the regular camera doesn't work. So you have to take that automatic, that battery camera. And then he had to put it in his down jacket and keep it warm inside. And you click a picture and put it back inside. Otherwise, it's gone. So this is what he did, and he got some 1500 photographs. We have this huge, more than 1500 photographs. And it's amazing, you know, every bit of his journey is with us, you know, and we sort of live it day by day. We go through it and we go, you know, live through it.
Wow. I think that's an absolutely amazing narrative, Anita. I think the book is inspiring, but I think more than that, this couple is extremely inspiring. And I think it's not only to think Everest, I think what they've shown in this book and in this journey is to be Everest, to be this presence, vast, generous, giving and receiving. And I think if we can find that metaphor in our lives, if we can apply that to our lives, then I think we'll have fairly satisfying journeys of our life too. So thank you very much, Anita. Thank you very much, audience, for sharing and for being there. Thank you, Janvi. And thank you, GujLitFest.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I think some emotional moments, disturbed memories, funny moments were shared over here, which were very inspiring for us and quite motivational as well. I want to thank once again all three of them for taking out time and being part of Gujarat Literature Festival. It was an absolute honor and privilege for having here and being part of this session as well as hosting this session. A lot of interesting sessions are still happening at the other two venues. Also, Irshad Kamil's band will be performing here at 6:30. So I hope to see you around over here. Thank you so much and I hope you have a great evening.